History Form 1. Topic 3. Economic Activities. Economic activities are mainly concerned with man's efforts to acquire food and other requirements for survival. Examples of economic activities are hunting, gathering, fishing, agriculture, craft production and mining. Economic activities are greatly determined by the environment. The environment refers to the physical conditions in a place. For instance, in the African continent, some communities live near large water masses and rivers, others live near the tropical forests, while others live in the drier areas such as the Sahel. All these environmental conditions influence the economic activities of the people. For economic activities to take place, people also need to apply certain skills or technology. Technology is scientific knowledge that is used practically. For example, technology can be used to design new tools and machines. The use of technology makes economic production more efficient. Technological development refers to the gradual improvement of scientific knowledge, which also leads to the improvement of skills, machines and tools. In the previous chapter, we saw the progress made by man during the Stone Age. The main economic activities during that age included fishing, hunting and gathering. During the late Stone Age, man discovered agriculture. In this unit, we shall study how different economic activities developed and how they changed man's life. Agriculture. Agriculture is the domestication of plants and animals. This process began over 10,000 years ago. The environment played an important role in this development. As we shall soon see, crops and animals were first domesticated in those regions where they already existed in the natural environment. In Africa, agriculture began in the Nile Valley in Egypt around 7000 BC. The following factors contributed to the beginning of agriculture. 1. There were plants and animals in the environment that could be domesticated easily. 2. As the human population increased, the natural environment could not provide adequate and regular food. People had to look for an alternative means of getting reliable food supplies. 3. Climatic changes such as increased drought and the resultant aridity threatened plant and animal life. This meant that man could not rely on nature alone for survival. Fun fact: the Sahara Desert in Africa is the largest desert in the world. However, that region was not always hot and dry. It was once a fertile area with many lakes, rivers and springs. The Sahara began to dry up between 5,000 and 6,000 years ago. 4. At other times, floods, bushfires and other natural calamities destroyed vegetation and killed or drove away the animals that man relied on for food. 5. Competition for food between human beings and animals increased, making wild food sources inadequate. 6. Sometimes people had to cover very long distances as they searched for food. These distances increased as food supplies diminished, making gathering and hunting tiresome. These, among other factors, forced the early humans to develop agriculture as an adaptation to the changing environment. It is possible that the early discoveries of agriculture were accidental. After the first chance findings, the early humans acquired practical understanding of agriculture gradually. Their surroundings played an important role in this development. This is supported by the fact that the first crops were grown in the areas where they naturally existed in the environment. Some of the earliest crops to be domesticated in Africa were sorghum and millet. The first animal to be domesticated was the dog. The relationship between agriculture, environment and technological development. There were three main types of agriculture practiced in ancient Africa: crop cultivation, pastoralism and mixed farming. There was a close relationship between agriculture, the environment and the technology developed to improve agriculture. We shall now look at the agricultural practices in different regions of Africa in order to illustrate this relationship. Crop cultivation. Different types of crops were grown in various regions of Africa depending on the natural resources. In some places people practiced shifting cultivation, while in other areas there was permanent cultivation of land. shifting cultivation. This involved periodic working of land. It was the most common method of farming in pre-colonial Africa. In East Africa, it was common in central, western and southern Tanzania as well as eastern Kenya. Shifting cultivation was practiced in regions where the natural vegetation was wooded grassland such as the Miombo woodlands in Tanzania. In these areas, the soils were light and fertility was easily exhausted. It was therefore necessary for people to keep moving to more fertile areas. These regions had low population densities, so there was enough land for farmers to move frequently. Under this system, after land was cultivated and planted for about 3 years, the yields would begin to decline. The farmers would then shift their farming activities to a new area. The main logic behind this farming practice was to allow the land to recover and regain fertility. It had another advantage of controlling the spread of certain plant diseases and pests. By the time farming resumed on a piece of land, most diseases and pests would be finished. However, this method of cultivation was harmful to the environment because the clearing of vegetation encouraged desertification. The crops grown under this system were mostly those that are drought-resistant. They included sorghum, millet, cassava, pumpkins, maize, castor and cowpeas. One type of shifting cultivation was the slash-and-burn method of land use. Slash-and-burn cultivation. This involved the cutting and burning of grass and foliage on a piece of land, then planting crops on the cleared land. The burnt grass and foliage fertilized the soil. The cleared land was used for a while, then the farmers would leave it and slash and burn a new area. This method was widely used all over the continent where there was irregular rainfall, poor soils and relatively low population density. It was common where the soil was soft and could easily be cultivated by the use of sticks or wooden tools. Permanent cultivation. Permanent cultivation was adopted in regions with denser population. The communities in such areas developed intensive farming techniques as there was no extra land to move to. They came up with methods of keeping the land fertile, for example by irrigation, terracing and application of fertilizers. In places where grains were cultivated, storage facilities were established to cater for the dry seasons. Many communities built granaries. Many of these communities also practiced mixed farming. This is the keeping of livestock alongside crop cultivation. Examples of areas where permanent cultivation was carried out included Egypt, Cambrai region in northeastern Togo, and amongst the Chaga on the slopes of Mt. Kilimanjaro, the Lozi of Zambia and the Akamba of Kenya. These regions received heavy annual rains, had fertile soils and forest vegetation. Such conditions could be found along the Indian Ocean coastline, north, northwest and west of Lake Victoria, central Kenya highlands, southern highlands of Tanzania, and on the slopes of Mount Usambara, Mount Meru and Mount Kilimanjaro. The Shamba of Tanzania mainly planted bananas in their rich mountainous farmlands. Crops such as yams and pumpkins were also common under this system of agriculture. We will now look at some of the methods that farmers used to ensure the continued productivity of land under permanent cultivation. Irrigation. Irrigation is the use of channels or pipes to supply water to a piece of land so that crops can grow. The ancient Egyptians practiced shaduf irrigation. The shaduf comprised of a long pole swinging up and down between two supporting wooden posts. On one end would be a heavy load and at the other end there was a skin bucket. The bucket was pulled down and dipped into the river by one person. The weight on the other side would then cause it to rise up to another person above, who would empty the water into the canals that led water to the field. In East Africa, the Chaga of Mount Kilimanjaro and the Akamba of Kenya also practiced irrigation. The Chaga cultivated finger millet and bananas using water from the rivers that flowed from Mount Kilimanjaro. The Lozi used the floods of the river Zambezi to expand their food production through irrigation. Other communities that practiced irrigation in Tanzania included the Meru, Per and Samba, who used furrows to channel water to their farmlands. Application of fertilizers. The Buhaya on the western shores of Lake Victoria improved the fertility of their land by transferring animal manure from the pasturelands to the farmland. The farmers of Ufipa, Ankole and Buganda buried plant remains in mounds of earth. These mounds conserved water, prevented soil erosion and also served as compost manure for the crops planted on them. In Tanzania, the pear, chaga and samba as well as the people on the islands of Ukuru and Ukara used animal manure and compost to enrich their farmland. Crop rotation. This involved the seasonal rotation of crops on the same piece of land. During the long rains, crops which tend to take long to mature would be grown. On the other hand, crops like cereals that mature fast would be planted during the short rain season. Since the various crops used different nutrients from the soil, crop rotation ensured that soil fertility was protected. Intercropping. This was a very common method of cultivation and soil conservation in pre-colonial Africa. It involved planting different crops or different varieties of the same crop on the same piece of land. Among the Swazi of southern Africa, grain was intercropped with pumpkins, gourds, melons, cowpeas, beans and sweet potatoes. The Manganja of southern Malawi intercropped maize with beans and pumpkins. The advantages of intercropping included. The mixture of crops on a piece of land provided a cover of plants over the soil. In this way, the land was protected from soil erosion caused by excessive rainfall and winds. B. The available soil mixture and plant nutrients were fully used because of the plants' different and complementary nutrient requirements. C. The spread of pests and diseases was reduced because different plants are less likely to be attacked by the same pests and diseases. D. The growth of weeds was reduced. This helped in minimizing the labor required for weeding. E. The use of sunlight was maximized because different plants have different growth characteristics and requirements. F. The risk of crop failure due to drought and other problems was minimized. If one of the crops failed, the others would survive and serve as food for the community. Agroforestry. This is the growing of trees in the same fields where food crops are cultivated. This was especially common in Zimbabwe prior to the colonial era. From the trees, farmers would get benefits such as fruits, firewood, fibers, timber and at times fodder for their livestock. The trees helped in the maintenance of soil fertility as some produced large quantities of leaves which served as compost. Terracing. Terraces are flat step-like areas that are cut into the side of a hill or slope. Terracing is mainly done to manage loose soils in sloppy regions such as mountains and hillsides. Some farmers use stones to make the terraces. Examples of African groups that practiced terracing include the Akamba and the Taita communities in Kenya and the Pear, Samba, Nyakyusa, Sukuma, Nyamwezi and He of Tanzania. The Samba piled walls of stones which were reinforced with plant hedges to prevent soil erosion. Wetland agriculture. A wetland is a low area where the ground has a lot of water. Wetland agriculture was practiced to produce crops that could not do well elsewhere. The Temne of Sierra Leone used this method of farming to produce rice. In Zimbabwe, similar land use was known as dambo cultivation. This practice enabled farmers to grow food crops even during dry seasons. Pastoralism. Pastoralism is the practice of keeping livestock. In some areas, the keeping of domestic animals such as cattle, sheep, camels and goats took place earlier than the cultivation of plants. One important factor in the spread of pastoralism in Africa was the presence or absence of the tsetse fly. These flies cause sleeping sickness in humans and nagana in domestic animals. These diseases can be fatal. The pastoralists avoided the tsetse fly-infested areas, especially the moist low-lying valleys and thickly forested regions. The pastoralists benefited from their animals in several ways. 1. They acquired food, namely milk, meat and blood. 2. The hides and skins of the livestock were used to make clothes. 3. The animals were used as a means of exchange during trade. For example, animals could be exchanged for grains and vegetables or iron tools. 4. Livestock was a status symbol. People with a lot of animals were considered wealthy and were respected in the society. 5. Livestock was also important for religious and social ceremonies. For example, Cattle were used to pay bride price and as sacrifices to God. There were two types of pastoralism carried out in pre-colonial Africa, nomadic and sedentary pastoralism. Nomadic pastoralism refers to the seasonal movement of people with their livestock in search of water and pasture. Many nomadic pastoralists lived on milk, meat and blood. They also ate grains and vegetables obtained through trading contacts with the cultivators. Many nomadic pastoralists occupied the scrubland and the savanna regions. These areas get little rainfall. Examples of nomadic pastoralists in Africa include the Tuaregs and Bedouins of North Africa, the Fulani of northern Nigeria, the Bagra and Agar of the Sahara, the Oromo and Somali of Kenya, the Karamojong of Uganda and the Maasai of Tanzania and Kenya. Sedentary pastoralism. Sedentary means staying or living in the same area. Sedentary pastoralists did not move from place to place. They were mainly former nomadic pastoralists, for example the agricultural Maasai, Kwavi. The animals kept by such communities were fewer than those kept by nomadic pastoralists. How agriculture changed man's life. 1. Agriculture led to the production of more and regular food for the society. This in turn led to an increase in the population. 2. Agriculture forced people to settle down in one place. This is because farmers had to prepare the land, take care of their farms to prevent them from being destroyed by wild animals, and harvest the crops. Even the fast-growing crops required at least several weeks from the time they were planted until they were ready for harvesting. 3. After settling down to farm, humans had to establish rules and regulations to govern social life in the community. This encouraged social and political organization. 4. Agriculture led to the production of more than enough food for the community. The surplus was exchanged for other products with neighboring communities. As a result, many people interacted through trade and some market centers emerged. Some of these markets grew to become urban centers. 5. Some people acquired more land and animals than others. Thus, they became wealthier than other people in the society. This created class differences between the rich and the poor. 6. The agriculturalists were forced to come up with new religions that could serve their needs. For example, they needed new gods that could protect flocks and crops or ensure the fertility of the land. 7. Agriculture also impacted on the scientific and technological knowledge and skills in the society. Farmers began to take interest in weather knowledge to know when to plant and cultivate successfully. This led to the development of astronomy. In Egypt, there was need for irrigation, which led to the invention of the shadouf. Mathematics also became necessary. The farmers needed to count the numbers of livestock, to calculate the amount of food in the granaries and to have a system for dividing land. 8. Since the farmers could produce enough food for the society, other people began to practice medicine, priestly duties or different crafts. Agriculture therefore encouraged specialization of roles in the community.